Okay, we good? Okay, let's get going. I'm going to skip my picture I had up there first. We'll circle back to it if we have time. I just want to make very sure that we get through everything. The topic here is water. Okay, we've been talking about soil, and we've talked about water in the context of like ocean currents and air and water moving through the system. Here we're going to kind of link the ground and the air and the water all together, and we're going to talk about where water resides in the environment, kind of how it gets there, where it goes to, and that, taken with everything else so far, hopefully is going to paint a picture of all the conditions that support life. We're trying to get to a point where we can start talking about the living system. We're still on the physical, non-living system. And this is one last piece to that, okay? So here you can see some learning objectives for this topic. The top three are right out of your book, as we have been trying to focus on those kind of main ideas. I did add one here, something we tend to focus on in this class, the making connections piece, and I'll try to illustrate a few of those during the lecture. But we know about how some parts of the earth are warmer than others. Some parts are always cold, some parts are always warm. We know about how precipitation patterns can vary depending on where you are. 30 degrees from the equator, for example, tends to be dry. You get high enough off a mountain, tends to be dry. Okay, we want to be able to explain why that is. We understand a little bit about, where, like I said, this is about where water resides and how we can get at it and some of the different challenges maybe associated with that. So let's start with some vocabulary, a little recap of the water cycle. This graphic down here is from your book. I'll talk about that in a second. The water cycle diagram there, that's a very kind of generic one. It's from the USGS. And it's worth highlighting, I think, just to make sure we're all on the same page. Okay, the water cycle, also known as the hydrologic cycle. Okay, when that what we're talking about is the movement of water from the liquid form into the gas form and back again. Okay, through the environment, evaporation from the surface of either bodies of water or the ground. Into the air, it gets high enough in the atmosphere that it cools and condenses, goes from gas to liquid. Okay. Eventually, we get precipitation. Gravity is going to pull that water back down to the surface. Gravity is then also going to pull that water down to the lowest points, whether that's the bottom of the valley or down into the soil. Down is the path it's going to follow. And I should point out, just for what it's worth, down, right? Not necessarily south. Or, people like to think, oh, rivers only flow south. No. Rivers flow downhill. Okay. Downhill can be north or east or west. One thing I'll point out on the diagram here, transpiration. That is the term used to describe the loss of water through plants. These plants are metabolizing, they're photosynthesizing, and they are transpiring as they do that. Water is leaving through their leaves, through the stomach, into the atmosphere, and it is not evaporation. And evaporation would be water changing from liquid to gas in the environment, changing phases. This is the result of plant metabolism, transpiration. But significant nonetheless. Cloud forests, tropical rainforests, these are really wet, tree-filled places. We get, if you look at satellite imagery of tropical forests, you'll see clouds developing over it as a result of transpiration. Condensation, I already talked about that. This is turning from gas to liquid. Okay. Precipitation is the name we give that liquid as it's falling to the surface. Infiltration. Not shown on the diagram. This refers to the process by which water ends up in the ground. Okay, groundwater. What that looks like and what that means is something we're talking about. But this is the oft-forgotten place that water goes, right? We all picture the lakes and the rivers and the wetlands of different types. Everybody seems to remember that a lot of it's frozen in the ice caps, but we tend to kind of forget about the groundwater. And groundwater is a decent chunk, almost a quarter, of all the fresh water that exists on Earth. So if you take a look at those two little pie charts down there, on the left, this is all of the water on Earth. Of all of that water, 97% of it is ocean, it is salt water. That is not going to grow our crops, that is not going to hydrate us, that is not going to hydrate most things that don't live in the ocean. Fresh water is what is necessary for all of these things to happen. Fresh water is just a little sliver. If you take that sliver and break it down, you can see where it's distributed. Most of that is frozen, at least it was. Still, a very small percentage of it exists as what we call surface water. Okay, bodies of water called surface water. Even smaller chunk exists as vapor in the atmosphere. A small chunk, but I would point out, a really important greenhouse gas. And you got this big chunk underwater. Underground. Below ground. So this is a precious resource here. Okay. We are fortunate to live in a part of the world where fresh water is relatively abundant. But in many parts of the world, that is not the case. And we'll talk about some of the challenges associated with that also. This idea of water scarcity, I should point out, is something that we will cover in depth later. Talk a lot more about social and cultural implications and the economics of it. This is about the system, the Earth system, and kind of where these things are and how they work. More on that. So, the water cycle, right? We talked about evaporation, condensation, all this movement of water between phases, between different spheres in the Earth system. One important connection, the water cycle, to some stuff we've talked about already, it's something that didn't, was a big part of our last meeting, but felt like it was worth kind of reinforcing, which is this, that we talked about how the climate of an area can be affected by a lot of different things. And the proximity to an ocean or any large body of water is a really big, important factor when it comes to determining the climate of the place. Okay? We did talk about an example in Europe. We talked about the Gulf Stream moving all of this heat away from the tropics through the Atlantic and across towards the European continent. And it has all of that heat, all of that warm, evaporating water vapor. It has a lot to say about, a lot to do with why Europe has the climate it does, why Europe isn't frozen solid like the middle of Canada is during winter. And that warm ocean water has a lot to do. Warm water evaporates a lot, okay, more than cold water. Water in the atmosphere, okay, leads to precipitation. Right, that's how we, that's one place, that's why it's raining, because water ends up in the atmosphere by evaporation, partially. Okay? So these evaporating warm currents can really affect the climate on these nearby land masses. And by extension, if you flip that around, cold currents, parts of the world, for example, the West Coast, South Africa, South America, the West Coast of Africa, parts of the world where we have cold surface currents, cold ocean water either coming up from the bottom, in your upland zone, or north from the Antarctic regions. Really cold water. Cold water evaporates less. It's not going to create as much rainfall, perhaps, as a warm ocean current. What's also true is that that's
a cold surface, that ocean water, onto which warm water vapor can condense. And that's exactly what happens. Motion up against the Andes along the west coast of South America and down in this part of South Africa, southern Africa, I should say, including South Africa. We have deserts. We have deserts for a few reasons. One is we're kind of right at that sweet spot, right outside the tropics, right around the edge of the tropics, where it tends to be drier. But what's also true is we have these cold ocean currents sucking water out of the air, evaporating less, but actually removing water from the air. It's a cold surface. Water is condensing. Add that, you know, add the winds blowing any evaporating water off of that continent, and you have a few different things conspiring to make that part of the world really dry. It has a lot to do with evaporation or no evaporation. You can trace it back to those fundamentals. A good example of the kind of thing you would hope that you can get to when you can figure out. These are pretty great animations over here. I kind of skipped past them. And what you're seeing, if you figured it out, the days are ticking by at the top there. So you can see the sunrise, you can see daytime and nighttime. And you see, during when the sun is shining, you see a lot of evaporation. A lot of evaporation from the continents. Right? If you look at where the water vapor is, okay, it's residing largely in the tropics. This is South America right here. Okay. You can see Coriolis effect, you know, having the Coriolis effect impacting the movement of that water vapor. And you can see precipitation. Okay, we got this band of really active kind of precipitation zone here in the tropics. We have these swirling kind of patterns outside of that. And it's kind of two distinct, if you look at it long enough, two distinct bands of purpose. And all of that traced back to movement of water, changing phases of water. Impacts on climate, everything that we're talking about. Questions? So, again, water scarcity is something that needs to be at least mentioned today. We'll get deeper later on, especially when we talk about growing populations. This is a, in your textbook, a map that looks something similar to this. It's a little different. This is projections for where there stands to be high water stress or water scarcity. The map in your book is something very similar, but it's not a projection. It's kind of the current stats. So it's a lot of parallels. But it's important to know the difference. I've already mentioned that water is distributed inequitably, meaning it's not everywhere all the time. Okay, and therefore it is going to be obviously more abundant to some populations than others. And if you take a look at the map, if you think about it critically, why do we have these low estimates for per capita water? By the way, what does per capita mean?
Per person,
thank you. So how could you influence that? What would influence the per capita water availability in a given place? We give you a little mathematical addition here to help. The amount of people, okay? So if I have a lot of people, that's one way that water becomes more scarce. Okay, even if I have a lot, if I have enough people, eventually I run out. The other way would be to decrease the amount of accessible water. Both of those things are happening, and then you have a special kind of problem. You may have heard the news, it's been going on for a while now in South Africa. They are well into a water crisis, over a couple years now, where they're actually starting to turn off water supplies and cut back usage, mandatory usage cutbacks, because it just simply hasn't rained enough. We have growing populations, and we have dwindling resources. And that's a theme that we see in a lot of places around the world. And it's especially problematic in places that are already on the dry side, which often lost the can you identify reasons why precipitation would vary from place to place? Naturally occurring, like, you know, natural global systems are at work here. Can we identify the gaps, places where it tends to be dry, tends to be wet, for example? We've seen a few examples. Okay, so I do want to, I'm glad this is here, it turns out, bodies of water, half of 1%, okay? And one of the things that, it's kind of a small thing, but we need to stop and talk about it. I'm going to talk a lot about groundwater in a minute, so let's leave surface water, it's deep. Ponds and lakes. We know, like, rivers, streams, all these things, you know, we're not so worried about what's a river versus a brook versus a stream versus a whatever, okay? There are some cultural reasons why people call stuff different, some type of reasons. Really is not important to us. But we are interested in fresh water versus salt water. We are interested in groundwater versus surface water being able to tell us. So ponds and lakes, these are one way or another, however they form. We have a depression that is being filled by precipitation runoff, which is the term given to water that is moving across the surface. It has not soaked into the ground. It has not been taken up by plants. It is runoff. Some lakes can be salty. Some lakes are spring-fed and crystal clear. Whatever the case, we have these unique situations all around the world, all these different scenarios in which lakes form. A couple interesting examples. Some are very salty. The salty ones tend to be parts of oceans, oceans that got kind of isolated as oceans and Earth's plates and such move around. We ended up with these little lakes that became isolated. Uplift happens, and that kind of plates lift up parts of an ocean, parts sink down, and we get salty lakes. Other lakes, like I said, can just be extensions of groundwater. So in some cases, what you're seeing is literally just water coming up from the bottom. In other cases, it's water being collected from hundreds, thousands of miles around. Okay? They can be big, complex systems. They can be relatively small. The graphic there from your book, just kind of an interesting little tidbit. Two of the Great Lakes are on there. Three of the Great Lakes are on there. Not bad. Depends on how you think about it. You can measure them by depth or volume or surface area. Different people like to measure different ways, but these are the kinds of places you might see show up in a question here and there. Not that we're going to expect you to know off the top of your head their whole story. But when we hear about lakes and aquatic systems, we might see them. Okay, let's talk about groundwater. The term is aquifer. We refer an aquifer is pictured here. Okay. The way groundwater looks, the way it feels, is like that water in the hole. Okay, when I say aquifer, you should not be picturing some magical underground lake. That's so different. This is saturated dirt. Okay, that's what this is. This is, you dig down deep enough that there's standing water in your hole, well, then you have reached the water table. The water table represents the top of what's called the saturated zone. Okay. Excuse me. If you take a look at soil, this picture up here on the right, we talk about particle size, a little bit of texture, soil texture. What's important to remember is that there are spaces in between those particles. Okay. And air and water are going to fill those spaces. And that is the space that, when your ground is saturated, that is filled with water. Okay. So here, these people have dug down deep enough to build a fence, which is a difficult fence condition. Important lifestyle. But you dig down deep enough that there's standing water. That soil is saturated.
You can reach the water table.
The infiltration rate refers to how quickly water gets from here down to here. Okay? Because aquifers are recharged by precipitation. They are refilled. Recharge is the name of by precipitation. When we take water out of an aquifer, we are withdrawing water. So when withdrawal is greater than recharge, when withdrawal exceeds recharge, the water table drops.
Okay.
Questions there? This graphic is not like the sexiest graphic in the world, but it really does a good job of showing you what's going on. Okay. Notice the water table extends into the surface water. Question? Aquifers. No? Good question. It can vary typically. So, like when the water, so let's say it's a really dry summer, the water table's going down. What you're going to see? Yeah, that's an extension. If you're standing on the bank of a river, if you picture that water going straight into the bank under you, like that's.
Water table can also be depleted by human use, which is something that we'll talk about a lot. So it's not like it's just always left. It's depleted over time.
Yes.
And a lot of times we call it fossil water because the water is down there from like 10,000 plus years ago.
Another term just worth clarifying here, something you're going to see. Aquifers can be confined or unconfined. A confined aquifer is, as it appears here, is in between two impermeable layers. Okay? Versus an unconfined aquifer, you can see, is not. It's unconfined. There's not an impermeable layer on the top. And the reason it matters is because it'll determine where and how the aquifer is recharged. All right, look at the graph. All right, the confined aquifer is only being recharged at the top end. The unconfined aquifer is collecting water from the wall. Okay. For example, another example, confined aquifers are under pressure. So if you stick a straw in for a well, water's just going to come out. You don't need to pump it. But an unconfined aquifer, you actually need to pump. You need like a motor or some horsepower or something. Recharge areas is something you might hear about and see. Yes, think about a little bit. Recharge areas. You know, these are the spots where aquifers are collecting from, and these are spots that can be of really vital importance when it comes to land management and land use decisions. We might decide this or that because this is a recharge area. That's not. So, speaking about the depletion or lowering water tables, talked about it a little bit. This is actually just repeated, just to reinforce it. But there's some terminology in the images that needs to be explained. We call it a cone of depression. If you've ever had dogs, then they don't talk about. Of depression. That's what we call it. This is different. This is what you see there. Okay. This is significant. One, because look at our neighbors up here, our farming neighbors in the right hand corner. We have three wells. No. We have three wells going into the same aquifer. One of them goes deeper and is drawing more, and by doing so, its cone of depression has reduced the other two wells to nothing. They are useless. So what's also true is if we are
this cone of depression can start to interfere with the saltwater that is very close by. And we call it saltwater intrusion when you start pulling saltwater from your well. You need a new well if you start pulling. All of this is, none of this is an issue if it's raining a lot. And we have high levels of recharge, for example, in our aquifers. If it's not, well, then we can end up having these issues. So, let's try to make a connection back to soil here. Talk about soils and their texture. And I made mention of this the other day, but I wanted to kind of reinforce again, formalize it a little bit. Soils that are very acidic tend to have high infiltration rates. Water gets in fast. What's also true is that they have low water retention rates, meaning the water leaves quickly. So sand isn't so great for growing your crops, for example. Water gets in, but it doesn't stick around. Which is why this mixture, this loam mixture that you guys heard about the other day, this mixture of sand, silt, and clay, is considered the ideal. It's sandy enough that water can get in down to plant roots, for example, but it's not so sandy that the water just can't move. Soils that are very heavy in clay have the lowest infiltration. Okay. Clay particles are tiny. They are laying on top of one another. They are packed in there. Those pore spaces in between them are very small. Pore spaces between sand particles are very large. Okay. So that's all true. Like in a physical sense, the texture, the quality of the soil, if you will have a lot to say about how much water ends up in it. What's also true is that the parent materials that form the soils can have an effect on that water once it's in there. And something you read a tiny bit about, which is going to become a bigger topic later on, we haven't talked about pollution very much, but acid rain came up. Acid rain occurs because chemicals, pollutants, sulfur oxides and nitrogen oxides, get into the atmosphere and react with water. Hopefully, this might look familiar to you. H2SO4, sulfuric acid. HNO3, nitric acid. A really strong acid. And they form in the atmosphere when water vapor encounters these free ions. Okay. And that's a problem, because that acid falls to the ground and has an effect. It affects the living system. But it turns out some living systems aren't so affected by it, and others really are. And that's why I have this up here. This is so super small print, and that's you can look at it on your own. You can take a look if you want. Frankly, that's all kind of extra stuff that we don't need to know. Just listen, and I'll show you what's important. These pictures are all of the major aquifers in the United States. Okay, and the different colors represent different aquifers and different soil types and such. And here in Missouri, and here kind of through this, you know, kind of the Great Lakes region here, and into Appalachia, the soils are, or the bedrock, I should say, excuse me, the bedrock underlying the soil are carbonate based. And that's, you know, carbonate is, it's think of seashells, okay, and high carbonates. Limestone is a carbonate-based bedrock that is an example of that. And limestone, you may recall, I had a big chunk of limestone in my pocket just a few minutes ago. Limestone is this gray rock that's part of the bedrock around here. What I'd like you to do, how am I doing on time?
Great.
What I'd like to do let's wait on this. I got a little demo here for you, but like I said, let's make sure we get through some stuff, okay? We'll have a little demo. You have a piece of limestone and some other rock and a weak acid. You can kind of witness the how you would take that. First, however, let's finish up with this aquifer for a second. Same map I just showed you. It's actually a slightly different version of that same map. This graphic over here is from the book. This is the High Plains Aquifer, also known as the Ogallala Aquifer. If you're like me and you think that's silly, you can just call it the High Plains Aquifer. That's also what it's called. And what you're seeing in that graphic are the changes to that aquifer over the past, over 55 years, 1950. And you can see first here, the one with the orange and the reds. The orange and the reds represent water level changes. Okay, so red is a greater than 45 meters, change in the water level. So like how deep is the water? And you can see parts of it have been much more heavily used than others. This other one here is the saturated thickness, just another way to kind of quantify how much water is present like right now, or is it 2005? Kind of like how full it is. Okay? And you can see the parts in Nebraska there that are darker blue. The parts that are not being overdrawn over here have more water, right? It's very logical, it makes a lot of sense. The reason these places are being used to the extent they are is obviously this is where we grow a lot of food. Okay? What's also true is as you move south, it gets warmer, it rains less, and you can start to see the effect of a more arid environment consuming more water versus it's not a hugely different place. Nebraska is it's far enough that it's different enough conditions that it's being recharged. It's the difference between its withdrawal versus recharge is less than it was that, for example. And this is the result of agriculture growing populations. Just a lot of more people means more water, means more food. And you see changes like this. Now, this is one little snapshot. The High Plains Aquifer is huge, okay? It is one of the bigger ones that I know about or heard of. Given that status, the fact that it is so large and has been so plentiful for so long, it is significant that it has changed this much in this 50-year period. That's a lot of water. What happens? So obviously, if it's not been raining, we're not going to get groundwater recharge. Surface water levels would drop. This is all fairly obvious. Drought. The other thing that could happen here, as a result of human interference, is flooding. Okay. We overdraw aquifers. And we do that in a place where water is already scarce. For example, this is Malawi, which is not so far from South Africa. So parts of the world like this, where there is a wet and a dry season, all the rain falls in the wet season. If we don't get any rain in our wet season, and then we have our dry season, the whole wet season and the whole dry season, I'm pulling water from whatever resources I have. Okay, then finally I get back to the next wet season. Let's say it doesn't rain again, or it doesn't rain as much as normal. Well, my aquifer is never going to get recharged back to the level it was at that rate, because I'm still drawing from it. I got to wait until the next rainy season to even have a chance to get the water in. Right? So you get this kind of compounding problem. Over years, when we have withdrawals happening but no recharge. You start layering on top of that social and political conflict, and you get some pretty ugly situations. Potentially. flooding thing, though, is another set of challenges altogether. In this case, what we're doing is we're building on the land that is supposed to suck up the water. Okay? We are creating impervious surfaces. We're increasing runoff and decreasing infiltration. Okay, if you look at the, so this is from 93. We've had some flooding since then in this part of the world. I understand that, but this is like especially catastrophic year. This picture has been all over the place. It's got so many different publications now, a lot of sites. But you can see Missouri River coming in. You can see Missouri River come down. You can see all of this developed land there. You know, I mean, that's your city. You know, that's there. You can picture it. And then you can picture it all underwater. You know, we build levees around rivers to try to keep the water in. More and more we see levees failing because waters are getting high enough that levees aren't big. We build dams. We do a lot of things to try to control water, but at the end of the day, if it doesn't have somewhere to go, meaning like into the ground, it's going to stay on top of the ground. It doesn't matter if really that's your neighborhoods or your farmland or whatever. It's going to be flooded until that water has been able to soak in, get soaked up by plants, or run off to some other place. So, we put this together with all the climate stuff, with all the soil stuff. Hopefully we're seeing a lot of the picture anyway, a big part of the picture of how matter and energy are moving through these systems in a few different ways that can vary, right? Climate varies, precipitation varies. Some of that natural, some of that affected by humans. Questions? Concerns? Do that. I got this all out, so let's do this. You're going to need to share one. You guys can come up and grab one bin. Anybody just grab one, share one.
Oh,
okay. You have two rocks. One of them is limestone, one of them is not.
What happens if you have three rocks?
You might have two pieces of limestone.
This is obviously.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come around and give you a little dropper with some vinegar in it. Drop a drop of vinegar on each of the rocks, and we'll see what happens. Stop by.
Stop!
What do you see when you drop the vinegar on the limestone? What? What else do you see? Look closely. Use the magnifier.
I can't see it.
Listen up, guys, please, before you go. Take a close look. Listen up. Take a close look when you drop the vinegar on the limestone. Especially if you let it sit there for a few seconds or so, you should start to see bubbles. Okay? The other stone, whatever it is, pick whatever is available. They're mostly igneous or metamorphic. You may see some bubbles, but not as much. Limestone-based soils, like the ones we have here, tend to buffer acid. Okay? Versus granite-based soils elsewhere in the country, not so much. Before you go, bring your materials back up, please.